Thank you very much, Corinne. Thank you. Hello, everyone. Hi. I'm from sunny São Paulo here in Brazil. It's a great pleasure to present our project, the project School 4.0 to you. My name is Pedro Chaves, as Corinne said. I'm a graduate student at the School of Electrical and Computer Engineering at University of Campinas in Brazil. And my research focuses on engineering education. I'm a part of a team that started small, our team, with some electrical engineers. But now this team has grown. We have chemists, we have physicists, we have education professionals. So we have a good team now working on it. However, in common, we all from this team, we want to help to prepare the new generations for this new world that's coming. The project School 4.0 intends to facilitate the transformation from that content-based, teacher-led class, that old style of class, to classes that are engaging, to multidisciplinary classes that involve projects that use technology as a medium. In other words, we want to help making learning an enjoyable experience. And how do we want to do that? That's the thing, that's the question. We intend to do that by advancing teachers' training, introducing computational thinking concepts, and guiding this teacher in teachers in their access to the new technologies. For example, using the microbit and all its educational ecosystem. Our objective is to empower our school teachers to use a variety of tools to reach all types of learners. Let me change the slide here. The project, still on the project School 4.0, we work mainly on three fronts. First is the development of tools and solutions, always open source. Everything we do is important to say is open source. So these solutions we've been developing for a while now to support primary and secondary school teachers. When we say primary, at least on our in Brazil here, primary would mean children from 11 to 15 years, and secondary would be the children that are between 16 and 18 years old. So we focus mainly on those teachers, primary and secondary school teachers. The second front that we work on is the training of undergraduate and graduate students, so they can train our school teachers. And the third front we work on is on the offering of distance learning courses to the community, MOOC courses, those massive open online courses, and via courses given by the University of Campinas Extension School. The university, which I'm part of, has a school just to offer courses. So there are ways we offer our courses. For example, we've got a 12-week long distance learning course. It has a long title, but I think the title is very nice because it says what the course is. The course we've been offering for the last 3 years, one of the courses, is called Development of Maker Activities to support the teaching of science, technology, engineering, arts, and mathematics, STEAM subjects, to primary and secondary schools. So I think it says everything we intend to do. That's our focus, is on the STEAM subjects to the primary and secondary school children. This course, this 12-week long course I've been talking, for example, it is split into two parts. In the first part, we present the theory, we use videos, We use written material, we run activities with our students. Always starting at a problem or a necessity that society has. In the second part of this 12-week-long course, we run maker activities. So why? To fix the concepts studied. And we include that code writing and hardware construction. I'm going to go into it into more detail, into the hardware construction shortly. Why? Because since not all schools, at least not here in Brazil, not all schools have maker spaces. This course we've been offering, it encourages the creation of these spaces at our schools, because the school children are going through our courses and they are being encouraged to have these spaces created at their schools. And we also share all the teaching material we use in this course, for example, with our students. So this material can be adapted, can be improved by the school teachers, and as I said, adapted to the local realities of each school. Carry on here.
Pedro, eu vou só pedir para você colocar no modo apresentação, que a tela tá fica maior.
Vê se ficou melhor.
Isso. Ótimo.
Ah, ótimo. Obrigado.
Thank you.
Right. Our intended audience. Yeah? Who do we want to reach with our courses? We want to reach those primary and secondary school teachers that I spoke before from both state and private schools. We have more state than private, but there is quite a large number of private schools too. They are all welcome to attend to our course. We intend to reach trainee teachers, course coordinators, school principals, and virtually anyone who is enthusiastic about improving youth education. They are all welcome to attend to our courses. The project, School 4.0, aims at training these professionals so they can pass on the knowledge to their students. So our idea is training the school teachers. They are going to act as the knowledge multiplier because they are the ones who work with the children. So we found this way to reach the children via their teachers. We've been doing this for a while now. Let me change my slide here. Our project, the project School 4.0, was initiated in 2019. So we are going to the third year now, passing the third year. We have already trained over 100 primary and secondary school teachers, as I said, via this synchronous distance learning extension course we've been offered. Now, we ran it in 2019, as I said. We ran it last year in 2020. And we ran it already this year, 2021, and definitely we are going to run it in the next year. Other main actions the project has gone through so far. We have run on-site workshops with school teachers and their students. We have gone to a few places to run these workshops there. Of course, those workshops were done before the outbreak of the pandemic. However, we would like to go back to them once it's safe to do so again. We are thinking about that and making plans for all that. What else have we done? We have promoted several online sessions when we invite people, not necessarily all teachers, but different people with different experiences to share these experiences with everybody. So we have had quite a few online sessions that are quite popular, actually. We have also taken actions with schools to help develop maker spaces. Always we try to explore active learning methodologies when we are working with maker spaces, try to develop these in these schools. We have also done quite a bit of research and development of open source solutions, hardware and software. As I said, everything we do is open source. So we have worked a lot in hardware and software development because these solutions can underpin our activities and focus in all ways we make our best to focus on social context of our young people here in Brazil. We try to make it interesting for them. Next slide. Important. Our motivation. Why are we doing this? Why have we started the project for the project School 4.0? Because we are all at a university, the University of Campinas, and we know that education is forever, and we know that education can change lives. So it was just natural for us to start this project. My advisor, my tutor, actually, at my PhD program, I'm going through at the university, he says that one is far more likely to climb the social ladder studying than playing football. The odds of whoever is studying, I am in favor of, if compared to whoever is trying to be a football player. So the idea is to study. The odds are much higher if you are studying. Motivation. We must prepare our youth to the challenges that lay ahead, as we said before. We know that the job market is undergoing a constant transformation. Innovations, cultural changes, all these end up being reflected in the emergence of new careers and, of course, the extinction of a few other careers. So actually, this process has accelerated in the last few years. We've been all feeling that, I'm sure. Challenges. What challenges have we been facing to run the project School 4.0? There are a few. We have had a few. We have been facing a few. However, I would like to highlight two here. Cost and coordination. If we're talking about cost, for example, I'm putting two figures here on this slide. One reads $18, the other one reads $53. So $18 is about the price of a microbit board in North America, in most of Europe. $53 is the price we pay for a microbit board here in Brazil. We are talking about three times the price. So for us, the cost of kits is one of the major challenges here. Why? Why is it so expensive to buy these boards? This is due to the high taxes levied on imports here in Brazil. And that's the way it is. However, there is a way to mitigate this. One could lower the costs of boards via a structured research and teaching project. Maybe we could have a national project done via a university or even a pool of universities, but it has to be done via universities. So it cannot be done via private companies. Yeah? That's the way, that would be one way to source components tax-free. There is a break in the law here in Brazil that allows universities with approved projects to import components tax-free. So there is a way out. That way, we could source hundreds, thousands, I don't know, millions of boards and carry out the project, projects, cool 4.0, why not, across the whole country, across the whole Brazil. The second issue we have here is coordination. Brazil is a big place. Brazil is continental, as I'm sure everybody knows. There is a great diversity here in Brazil on many aspects. We have diversity on social aspects, economical, geographical, environmental. So it's very, very, very diverse, the country. So we have about 50 million students. Just to keep in perspective, here in Brazil, we have about 50 million students. Ms. Magda Woods said this morning that there are about 6 million microbit boards in the world today. So only here in Brazil, we have 50 million students. So numbers speak for themselves. We've got about 200,000 schools, state and private, 200,000. We've got about 2 million education professionals. So the numbers are big when we talk about education here in Brazil. And it is an enormous task to coordinate the social policies here in Brazil due to size, country size, diversity, and also we have a decentralized nature of most public services. Here in Brazil, we have government layers. We have the federal layer, we've got a state layer, and also we have a local government layer. So, and these layers not always coordinate well. So it is one difficulty, one challenge we face every day. The coordination here sometimes can be a challenge. But now I'd like to talk about what we have been doing. Here, just to share with you, we've got a circuit board, basic circuit board. We have run the courses, as I said before, and an integral part of our courses are the experiments we run. As I said before, in the second part of our courses, usually you have experiments. And our project, the experiments we run, they are meant to be assembled locally, always using locally sourced materials. And, you know, so the school teachers that attend our courses, they can build it locally, all around Brazil. The idea is that anyone, anywhere can get hold of these materials. We, the project, School 4.0, we do not supply hardware. We don't sell, we don't give. What we supply are the templates. We provide the blueprints, and we teach how to build the experiments. For example, in this picture, I'm showing you, there is a circuit board for the teaching of electronic circuits. It's very basic. In this case, it's made of MTF, a few bolts and nuts and washers, and it's low cost, so it can be built anywhere, virtually anywhere in Brazil. People can get hold of these materials. So that's the basic circuit board we usually build, ask them to build. Why? To use in projects like this. Here, we have also developed some magnetic contacts. These are sticks, you can see. They're magnetic, so they stick to the washers we have on the board. Yeah? And these sticks, these magnetic contacts, they are fitted with LEDs, as you can see. We have some that are fitted with resistors, some have push buttons, some have buzzers. So all these are to be used with the circuit board and alligator clips. The good and old alligator clips being used everywhere. So that board, net board, everything is easily done and undone. You just have to disconnect it. It's easily done. So, and more than that, this experiment or this board, it can be replicated remotely anywhere in Brazil. Our students who have done our courses, they have built them to use with their students. Only to have a few more here, just to show you, we've got another, another board here. We also have some environmental initiatives. For example, this board in the picture, yeah, in the main picture, it does the same thing the one I just show you does, but this one is biodegradable. Yeah. It's made with the seeds of a berry-like fruit that's native from the north region of Brazil. It's called açaí. In English, the same name, açaí. So this, the picture on the left shows it looks like a grape somehow. So it resembles a grape. It has a pip, and that pip can be processed, and we can have boards like the one on the right hand side picture made with that material. So a board like this aggregates value to what would otherwise be a waste product. You know, the pip of the açaí is not used for anything. In this case, after being processed, it can be made into boards. So it's we loved that idea when it came up. It's one of our students who proposed that. Here, talking about our students, let me say, show a few of the open source projects, a few more that we've been doing with them. Here we've got, we have designed quite a few experiments to run with our students. That in turn, they use these experiments with their students. For example, in figure one, we've got an expansion board. We've developed this expansion board. It's open source again, as I said. We took the PCI slot, that white part in the middle of the figure one. It's a PCI slot, it's a peripheral component interconnect. It was taken from an old computer. So the cost was zero. We just take it from old computers that are not being used anymore. And that solution allows the connection to all input pins on the microbit. So those bolts you'll see there on the bottom and top, they are mapped to the input pins. So the students can use, again, the alligator clips to connect and have access to the microbit input pins. It's a very cheap solution to access. Then on figure number two, on the right, we've got what we call the piano bit. The piano bit uses that expansion board I just showed you, uses alligator clips, and the piano keys in the bottom of the picture with the musical notes written on, they are made from scrap plastic folders. We know that every school teacher has a plastic folder to keep their papers in. So that one was made from scrap plastic folders. With this experiment, the piano bit, for example, a teacher can explore concepts of music, musical notes, maths, programming. As you can see in the picture, we've got the microbit in the center, inserted in the expansion board. In blue on the top of the picture, we've got a speaker. And the middle of the picture, in white and green, is just a power source. So that's our piano bit that has been built by our students too, remotely. Picture number three, we've got our light and color kit. The circuit board there is a bit different, but same principle of the one I showed you in the slide before. It uses the magnetic contacts in the same way and made of MDF again. You can see the components are off-board. The LEDs are off-board. The resistors are off-board. And the whole thing is controlled by a microbit, in this case, programmed with make code. On the next slide, I've got another two examples of projects we have been doing with our students. On top of the picture, the figure four, we have a seismograph. As you can see, it's a block of wood on the left side of the picture. We've got a block of wood painted black, an adjustable ruler in yellow, screws and washers. That's all. The microbit that's fitted at the right hand side is fitted to the ruler, the tip of the ruler, and it plots the vibration felt at the tip of the ruler. In this experiment, for example, a teacher can apply concepts of physics and maths so easily. We've got here on the bottom of the bottom right side, our Bitmobile. In this case, we bought the wheels and the motor is all off the shelf, wheels and motor. The PCB in green was developed by the team. It's a low-cost PCB, open source. And you can see the micro bit is connected to it. It's very simple, very easy to assemble. And this can be controlled by a micro bit or by a mobile phone application. The idea, our idea on the project, School 4.0, is to develop experiments to teach several subjects. We are not only doing electronics. We want to experiment to teach chemistry, physics, electronics, naturally, maths, programming. So that's what we have been working for all these years. Here now I'm just gonna share with you two experiments from some of our students. Change it here. We've got the pendulum on the left, figure number six. Right? It's a very interesting experiment proposed and developed by one of our students who attended one of our courses. It's used to determine the acceleration of gravity. It uses a gyroscope to calculate the oscillation period of the arm. As you can see, that mobile phone is mounted on an arm that swings. So in this case, we used, the student at least, used a mobile phone because, well, not everyone, I should start saying that everyone has a mobile phone, but not everyone has a micro bit, at least yet. That's our plan. We'd like all our students to have microbits, or all students in Brazil to have access, at least. That's what our plan is. So in this experiment, the pendulum, teachers and students, they can explore concepts of gravity, vector decomposition, energy transformation. So there are many lessons that can be learned from this. The last one I'm going to show you is the intelligent traffic light. Again, developed and built by one of our students in figure seven. It uses a ultrasonic sensor to detect the presence of a vehicle, akin to those systems we find in shopping centers that show if a parking space is free or not. It's very similar. But in this case, they developed it using microbit, programmed with make code. That's the way they did that. Inside the red circle there, I try to show that there are three LEDs there connected to those clips. There is a green, a number, and a red LED, but it's not appearing much. But the idea is, if there is a car in the stopped at the traffic lights, it will control the time it is, the red lights are on, to make it as short as possible. So they managed to do it all using microwave. So these are some of the experiments the people who have attended to our courses have done so far. They have done many more. I just chose to share with you these two. So just to conclude now the presentation, I would like to show you, to present to you the members of our team that I said started so small and now has grown. And all these people have put a lot of effort into the project School 4.0. And many others, however, many others have also contributed to the project. So just to conclude the presentation, to summarize the presentation, I'd like to say that the concept of the School 4.0 has been tested and is already ready to be scaled up. So it works, we know. A structured university project would mitigate the cost problem caused by high taxation, giving Brazilian kids, Brazilian school kids at least, access to microbit boards. There is a need, of some sort of sponsorship to take this project off ground into maybe a national scale. That would be an idea. And with this project, we could get university students to work on the courses. And these university students that we are training, they could train these primary and secondary school teachers. And these, in turn, would pass the knowledge to their students. I think that's all I had to share with you. And I thank you all for having listened. Thank you.